Hello everyone, thanks for joining. This is about, as I call it, Project Coldplay, or how to use CNCF projects for adding music and announcements to my home elevator. I'm Erwin de Keizer. I'm a DevOps engineer by day and an elevator engineer at night. And this is my elevator. This is a door in the living room. It's sped up quite significantly. I think it goes twice as fast as it actually goes. We bought our house a few years ago, and it belonged to an old lady that couldn't walk the stairs anymore, and she had an elevator installed in the house. And we bought the house, and basically to remove an elevator is really expensive, so we have an elevator in our house. This is in our living room, and it goes from the ground floor to the second floor. If you count 0, 1, 2, if you're like, I don't know how it's all in English, Dutch, American, they call it differently, but so 2 floors of travel. It's really useful when moving heavy stuff, like a washing machine. And for the ones that have seen previous presentations, this is a washing machine I talked about at the GrafanaCon 5 years ago. And this is when it broke down and we had to remove it from the house. So a bit of background to the Project Coldplay. I think about 6 months ago, I was having lunch with a colleague, Ruan de Bruin, and we were talking about fun projects around the house. So I monitor my washing machine, I have automated my garage door, I monitor my power usage at home, and we were having a brainstorm about what could we do next, what could I do next. And he knew about the elevator, and the elevators at where we work, they all have announcements when you arrive at the floor, like really cheesy announcements. And I thought, oh, maybe we can add music to the elevator. And after visiting KubeCon in Detroit last year, while waiting for the plane at the airport in Detroit, people around us were talking about, oh, let's submit a talk for KubeCon in Amsterdam, like my home country. And there was a lot of talk about how to sell Kubernetes, why you should use Kubernetes. Kubernetes is awesome. And I thought, let's do something different. So I thought, hey, I have an elevator in my house. I'm going to submit it. And also gave me a very good reason to actually execute the project. So this is some pictures of the elevator. This is the door in the living room. You can even see our couch here. This is when you look up in the elevator. So you see the full shaft to the the actual roof of the house. This is the door to the first floor, and the door to the second floor is not visible here. And this is the electronics that are visible when you remove a panel in the elevator. And I know enough about electronics, I saw enough YouTube videos that I don't want to mess with this. But it also brings us to the goals and rules of this project. I want to know where the elevator is, so I can have proper announcements. I want music when the elevator is moving, so the announcements when the elevator stops at the floor. I don't want to break the elevator, and I don't want to mess with the internal electronics, because I'm not an electronics expert. This is actually very interesting if you look at it. Here you see lights, these correspond to the doors, so this panel knows everything. It knows that this door is open, the others are closed. But I suck at electronics. I had multiple issues with soldering just two wires together, so I'm not going to touch this. So it's basically a black box approach of monitoring the elevator. And this is the first attempt. This is an ultrasonic sensor, and I hooked it up to a Raspberry Pi. And I quickly got some Python code working to produce measurements. The distance seemed quite stable. If I put the sensor on a flat surface, there's not a lot of jitter. If I move it around, it measured all the distances in the home office quite well. But this also brings me to my first failure. These horizontal support beams in the elevator shaft, they prove a problem for the ultrasonic sensor. It's basically the sound waves traveling in a certain direction. It is a cone going up. And these horizontal support beams seem to produce echoes. Not very reliably, but they do it sometimes. It's already too much. The other thing is the top of the elevator platform that I want to measure is quite a small target for the ultrasonic sensor. It needs a bigger target. And the elevator shaft is too high. If you try to measure more than 4 meters with the ultrasonic sensor, it becomes unreliable. So it's a literal vertical scaling issue. So I come up with something else. This is a infrared sensor, the TF Luna. And it has a range, as reported by the spec sheet, of up to 8 meters. Accuracy of 2% of the measured distance. So at 8 meters, that would be about 16 centimeters that it could deviate. Frame rate of up to 250 hertz. And there's multiple ways to connect to it. You can have a serial connection where measurements periodically come in, or you do like a trigger-based, you ask for a measurement, you get a response back. And it can even have interrupt-based measurements where it's constantly measuring, and if it has a changing measurement, it will let basically one of the pins on the output will turn high, so you know that something changed. In the end, I chose to use the trigger-based mechanism. This is the setup. So here, this is the elevator shaft. This is the measured target, the top of the elevator platform. This is everything that moves. Here's the TF Luna, it's mounted at the ceiling of the elevator shaft. Like the full distance is about 7.5 meters, but the top of this platform is 5.5 meters. And in software, there's a measure component. I have written it in Rust. It runs on the Raspberry Pi that takes the actual measurements. Then it sends them through NATS, and then they're picked up by PromWriter that I wrote in Go. And it does remote writes into Prometheus. This is the message that goes over it. And the reason that I chose remote write with Prometheus is because the elevator doesn't get a lot of usage. It's sometimes not moving for a few days on end. And I don't need a very high resolution of metrics when it's not moving. Like once a minute is more than enough. But once it starts moving, I want to have a very high resolution. So when it's moving, I think it writes about once a second into Prometheus. So you can very clearly see how it's moving. And when it's not moving, you get a flat line. So this is the first result. It seems to be working. This is a full ride from the ground floor to the second floor and back. And it takes about 55 seconds to travel this distance. The speed seems pretty constant. And also, it's actually measuring the opposite of this, because the sensor is mounted in the ceiling and it's measuring the distance till the platform. So when the platform is at the top, it's a very low distance. But I correct that in Rust already. And also this part is when it's very close to the sensor. I think it's about 2 centimeters distance that it's measuring. There's also not a lot of noise. So the minimum reported distance of 20 centimeters seems like a safety measure, but 2 centimeters is also going fine. So I actually had reached the third goal already. I know where the elevator is. Some more charts. This is the absolute speed. So I do a PromQL query of the elevator height. And you see that it's moving about 10 centimeters a second, which also correlates pretty well with that it takes 55 seconds to go 550 centimeters up. And going up and going down, they're both almost exactly the same speed. It's a tiny bit faster going down, but not enough that you can actually feel it. It also doesn't matter if there's a lot of load on the elevator. If it's empty, if it's full, it's always these speeds. And now when I have the measurements, I can also do alerts. So I set up some alerts in Grafana that I know when something is wrong with the elevator. Like if it's stuck between floors, the way the elevator works is that you have to hold a button in the elevator to move to a floor. So if you release it, you can get stuck between floors. So if it's stuck between floors, something is wrong. I don't think it will happen anytime soon, but with two small kids. I want to know. If the elevator moves too fast, I also want to know. It's probably not going to happen because there's, I think, like 4 redundant safety systems in the elevator. But just to be sure. Also, if it moves too slow, I don't see it happening anytime soon, but it's probably a degradation in performance of the elevator itself if it happens. And it's just fun to know. And if the elevator is out of bounds, so if it suddenly goes into the basement that we don't have or too high, I really want to know. It's quite unlikely that this will happen. If it happens, it's probably an issue with either the sensor or my code, which are both far more likely. But I did run into an issue. So after I had this set up for a few weeks, I noticed that there was quite a lot of jitter. So you see the line is going up and down. It's about 5 millimeters to 10 millimeters in a full day. So it's not a lot, but it's enough that I started looking into it. I also got myself nerd sniped here. I started to think about, okay, the elevator is on top of the Earth is rotating. Maybe it has to do with direction that the Earth is traveling in. And the Earth, if it's aligned with it, maybe that gives different results. Space-time is shrinking, I don't know. I tried to calculate it, I couldn't work it out. So if there's any astrophysicists here, please come talk to me. But also, I realized, okay, it's a cyclical nature, it has to do with temperature. Maybe it's infrared temperature, maybe it has an influence. And I went over the spec sheet of the TF Luna again. And you can see here, it reports the temperature of the chip itself in an amazing resolution of 1/100th of a degree. And so let's add the temperature to the stuff we track. And after a few days of running, this chart came out. The red line is the temperature, blue line is the height. And this is a slightly cleaned up version. I take the average over 15 minutes. So the jitter like per second is a bit less. And you can see that there's actually pretty often it correlates with like a drop in temperature, drop in distance. It's still like the actual changes are very small. But you go from 2.7 to 2.5 centimeters here, so 2 millimeters, but it does happen when the temperature drop. But it also seems to happen a bit too much when the temperature drops. The temperature seems to drop in full degree increments. So here it's 30 degrees, 29, 30. It seems to, it reports it in 1/100th of a degree, but it's very clearly just measuring it in full degrees. And the slight drops probably come from me taking the average of 40 measurements before posting it. I do that within a second, but that's why you get values in between the temperatures. And every time the temperature drops or rises, the distance also changes. So it looks like the TF Luna is already doing some kind of error correction based on the temperature. Because every time it goes from 30 degrees to 29 degrees and back, the distance changes 2 millimeters. Between 30 and 31, it's 3 millimeters. Between 28 and 29, it's 4 millimeters. So it's a bit too much of a coincidence for this to happen. In the end, temperature is not really useful to make the measurements more reliable, but I did find it very interesting. Also, to detect if the elevator is moving, it's also not that relevant because these are changes in the order of 1 millimeter a minute. And once the elevator starts moving, it's 10 centimeters a second. So it's like 3 or 4 orders of magnitude difference. So let's get back to the software architecture. In the end, this is what I came up with. Basically a microservices approach. On the Raspberry Pi, we have 2 components, measure and speaker, that do the actual measurements and speak the announcements. And then we have the scientist, which is of course a Coldplay song. that does the actual thinking of the whole project. So it takes all the measurements and decides, should we play music? Should we update the user interface? Should we send it to the Prometheus? And these two have to live on the Raspberry Pi. The others can live wherever, because they only have to be on the same subnet. And the subnet, in this case that I use, is related to Tailscale. I'm not sure if anyone knows about Tailscale, but it's an awesome product that basically allows you to build a overlay mesh network between all your own devices. So no matter where a device lives, if it's on the tailnet, it can connect to other devices on the tailnet. So my laptop is in the same tailnet as those devices. I even have had something running on fly.io. They can also live in the tailnet, so it makes all the connections a lot easier. Also has ACLs, and it uses WireGuard for the underlying safe connections. This also brings me immediately to the second failure. This is too much. I'm an elevator engineer by night. This is not my J job. Maintaining 5 components at a time just became too complicated. I had issues with restarting services. What should I name services? Like, the scientist was pretty easy. How do I name the other services? So I thought to myself, there's no problem in distributed computing that a bigger monolith cannot solve. Erwin de Keizer right now. So this is the new architecture I came up with. It's called Paradise. This is a monolith in Go. Also a Coldplay song. It does everything. It writes to Prometheus, and Grafana is of course used to read the results. So on the evening, I started rewriting everything, and I quickly got a nice monolith together. But there was something curious with that. So the Go version, it also uses I2C to connect to the TF Luna, just like the Rust version. All the commands were basically the same. It's like writing and reading memory blocks. But oddly enough, after running for a few minutes or a few hours, the results got stale or nonsensical. So in this case, like this measurement is exactly the same for 4 minutes, and there was always a lot of noise. So that was quite strange. I restarted it, and it seemed fine for 10 seconds. Then it returned minus 15 centimeters. So it's below the ground at that point. Then it jumped up and it comes stale again. But when this happens, I could kill the Go monolith and rerun the Rust program. And it got those same stale measurements. Even using the command line tooling to directly read the results, those same stale measurements. And I couldn't get it to work. I started looking into the sensor, there's a reset command, basically triggers a reboot of the full sensor. That worked for a few seconds, but then it got stale again. And then I thought maybe the sensor is overheating. And I started adapting the time between measurements based on the temperature of the sensor. So when it got too hot, back off longer. But in the end, I couldn't get it to work. And I was talking to my colleague Ruan again. Throughout the project, we kept in touch. He was like, you can't give it a taste of crap and then just expect it to not hate you for taking it away. For those unaware, Ferris, that's the unofficial crap mascot of Rust. And I think he was right. So I adapted the infrastructure again. And this is the software architecture 3.0. So now we have Paradise, that is written in Rust, that only takes measurements and writes them to nuts. And Yellow is one part of the duolith, as I call it now, that takes all the measurements and articulates the speaker, updates the user interface, and sends measurements to Prometheus. And this turned out to be very stable. This has been running for a few months now in our house, and I never had issues with the sensor anymore. So now came the hardware. This is the top of the elevator shaft. At this point, the elevator is, I think, 20 centimeters from the actual floor. So this is between floors. This triggered an alert. I'm standing on a step here to take pictures. Here you can see, I think it's a backup electric motor to take the elevator down if the main motor breaks down, something like a fuse box. This is a TF Luna. Here you see wires running to a hole that was already in the ceiling. So I think the people that designed the elevator thought about this use case and made sure there were holes for this. And this is the speaker that was that I connected. It is a Bluetooth speaker, but I connected it with an audio cable because Bluetooth adds quite a lot of latency. And I wanted the time between starting to move and the music starting be as short as possible. And everything is connected with magnets. On the one hand, because I fucking love magnets. On the other hand, because I don't want to break the elevator. And so I attached all this, and I wanted to try out if the speaker was working. So I SSH into the Raspberry Pi, and I start triggering commands like speaker test, some stuff with ALSA mixer, and I couldn't get it to work. I got strange, like segfault errors, device not found, no sound card present, and I couldn't figure out what was going on. So I started Googling and I noticed, oh, I have to update some kernel flags, and I restarted. Oh, I also had to recompile some things. In the end, I think I spent at least 4 hours, but I couldn't get it to work. And then a few days later, I SSH into the Pi to reset Paradise, but the systemd unit was not found. I was like, what the fuck is going on? Then I realized that I have 2 Raspberry Pis in my house, so I was connecting to the wrong one. There's one in the garage that triggers the garage door and one on top of the elevator. And when I SSH into the correct Raspberry Pi, it worked immediately. I will now give you a short overview of the elevator. So this is the control panel. iPad is not included, it's just to show the user interface. And if you look up, you can also see the actual hardware there. This is I'm not sure, it's like a corkscrew going up that is used by the backup motor to take the elevator down. Here you see the TF Luna. You also see two small lights because the camera sensor of my phone does pick up infrared. But in reality, you see nothing here because it's like proper infrared. And this is the speaker and the cables. I will also show you the user interface. It's a bit bare bones, but it does update in real time. And this is the full HTML/JavaScript code for the user interface. And it uses server sent events to update the user interface. It's basically like a WebSocket connection, but it only goes to the client from server to client. These are Go templates. This is the index.html page. Here you see that it includes the template height, which is this template. So when you request the index.html, you get the full page. And then it sets up a server sent events connection to the event stream. And when a message comes in on that event stream, this div here will be swapped with the incoming message. And what is sent on the service and event stream is basically this HTML snippet. So it's the same template that gets included here. It just gets updated with the new values. And this happens with Go channels whenever the measurements change. So it's quite real time. And also, if you take a look here, it's very close to a rounded value again. Then the music. Patrick really wanted me to elaborate on Muzak. When I mentioned this project when we were having lunch about half a year ago, he's like, oh, you have to talk about Muzak. He's like, what is Muzak? Well, basically, Muzak is to background music what Google is for internet search. So it's music with all the exciting stuff taken out of it. So it's very pleasant to have it in the background. So there's usually no one actually singing, like the high notes. It's all just very mellow. And then one of the first things I did for this project was actually started looking in some free to use Muzak. But in the end, you should also look it up, because it's there's like a lot of elevator music out there, and they're like the really cheesy ones, like that. It's like, you should look it up. But in the end, I just decided to use a different kind of music. And the first one to guess where the music is from wins stroopwafels, because we're in the Netherlands. And if you take this to the full stack stand, you also get some nice things. So please pay attention and just shout it out if you're recognizing. Also, this, when the elevator starts, it's quite a loud sound, so be prepared for that. Does anyone recognize it?
Like
no, it's too bad. Now I have stroopwafels for me now.
Abba.
Yeah. Max Payne. It's the elevator sound from Max Payne. I understand if you don't really recognize it, because I think the game came out over 20 years ago now, So actually, I now have 2 out of 4. Well, maybe it's 3 out of 4, because I still didn't break the elevator. And there was only one more thing to add, was the announcements. And it actually turned out not to be that complicated, because I had all the logic in place. I know when the elevator is moving. I know when the elevator stops. I have measurements of where it is, so I know at what floor it is. But first, let's go over the challenges of this this project. So I think the biggest one, it's a major one for me, is using Go with I2C and the TF Luna. I still don't know what's going wrong there. Maybe I'm triggering some kind of race conditions, but I couldn't get it to work. Also, SSHing into the wrong host when testing audio is a very big issue. I also thought that I broke the Raspberry Pi several times. I even bought a new SD card, and I was about to plug it in when I got to the top of the elevator shaft, and I noticed that the network switch was just disconnected. So I plugged it in and everything started working immediately again. Having 2 copies of the measuring software running at the same time also produces some unexpected results. This is because I use a trigger-based mechanism, and a few times I didn't shut down the systemd unit when testing, and then there were 2 programs triggering the measurement and reading the result in tandem, and that gives very weird results as well. I suck at soldering, so basically these 3 are all related to the real world. I really like software, because it's much more predictable than having to do stuff with the real world. Another thing that was complicated once I started talking to embedded devices and audio device is that cross-compiling becomes complicated. Usually Go is very easy to cross-compile. Once you have embedded stuff, it just doesn't work. So in the end, I decided to use the VS Code remote development environment. So I actually develop on the Raspberry Pi itself and I compile everything there. It's a bit slower, but it does work. So it's a very easy trade-off to make. And another big challenge is nerd sniping myself. I'm still convinced that the rotation of the Earth has something to do with the measurements. It's also my next project coming up. I want to measure it over a longer period of time to see if that also changes with the seasons. Good morning. And I had to tell myself also multiple times that I don't need a completely automated pipeline to transform pictures of the graphs that I draw on a notebook into nice inverted graphics for in the presentation. I did make it though. It took me another day, but I did get it to work. So this is actually the end result. And I will show you how it all came together. You also see the interface updating. Thank you so much. So this smile, this is truly the smile of someone that spent way too much time on doing this. All the code is open source at on GitHub, gnur/coldplay. And feel free to leave feedback about the session with the QR code. And thank you all so much for joining.